Okay, moving on to the next story before Skype crashes.
Alright, so now you're on this web neutrality thing.
Yeah, I don't know what they're thinking here. Basically, people have been bitching about this to the channel, at least five people actually. What they've subscribed to is this basically law strikes and you're out. You're going to get accused of piracy, and they'll send you a warning, because apparently people are only pirating because they're uneducated. They're claiming this is an education program to teach people about how piracy is wrong, and by pirating they're hurting people, and, you know, and basically they think...
Yeah, that's like saying, like, I grew a seed from a plant that I bought from the supermarket, you know?
Yeah.
How does that hurt a farmer if I'm farming myself?
Basically, if you're... what happens is, okay, some copyright holder says, blah, blah, is serving my content without permission. That is in no way, shape, or form verified. They just make the allocation. Then anybody who accesses it gets a strike. They get sent a warning. If they access anything else that's been reported as in violation again, they get another strike. They get sent a more stern warning, and their web page, when they log in and open a browser, it may redirect to a, you have been accused of piracy, understand, acknowledge your accusement of piracy, you know, yada yada. And it'll get more and more stern, and make using the internet more and more sonic.
If you're posting someone else's content, like in a YouTube video, how's that, I don't understand.
Anywhere. If they determine that certain torrents are piracy. Anything. A website, a YouTube video, yada. You're accessing pirated content. They're gonna. So just by accessing it, you get a strike for accessing the pirated content. You're saying, it could be something as stupid as I go watch the episodes of Reboot on YouTube. And they're like, oh, no, you're accessing them on, those are pirated content, you are accessing pirated content, you get a strike.
My belief on that should remain at the individual property level, and that if they want to make an accusation, then it's just like if that person made a breach elsewhere. You have to cite them. In other words, you can't block the internet. You have to circumvent the supply chain. You go after the individual. If they have a problem with the individual, then you're going to have to initiate litigation.
I agree with that, because this is ripe for the same abuse we get with websites and YouTube and everyone else, which is, you know, I don't like them. I know, they're a pirate. Because this is the shining icing on the cake. Okay.
This would be like a higher authority telling GM not to sell me a car because of my driving behavior.
Yeah.
It makes sense. If you have a problem with my driving behavior, you come after me and initiate litigation.
And you know what's even worse about it? It's in the it's in both the ISPs and this created third-party authority's best interest to take as many frivolous complaints as possible. Because here's the process. I get a strike. I know what I accessed is not pirate. I'm not pirating. I didn't access pirated content. I say, this strike's invalid. The strike has been reported in falsehood. Oh, sir, we can do an audit of that strike for $20 or $35 or $40. Basically, they get paid to review false claims and straighten them out. That's insane right there. It's like they say, well, we have to pay for the third party review. Why is there even a third-party review? You know, this is the same crap we have with patents. Like, if you think there's an infringement, go after the infringer. Oh, no. Pointless survey. Is there one person here who thinks this will stop a single act of piracy?
No, I don't think there's any of them.
Okay. Is there one person...
Here's what I'll say, is that Russia's going to get really busy.
To what?
That's probably...
Russia, very busy. Think about it. I mean, if all these ISPs want to shut down here in the United States, there's going to be a whole lot of Russian business going on.
Yes,
I am coming over.
Yes,
I mean, I'm just saying that these other countries, they'll just be like proxies all over the damn place.
Yeah, there'll be a lot of paid proxying going on and other stuff because they're going to be logging to the
pipes. And then what's next? They're going to DMCA the hubs from the United States, and then we'll be just like China. So there you go.
Yeah, well, no, that's the only way they could ironclad enforce that. You said, if we become just like China, this is one of the reasons I don't want the government to have anything whatsoever to do with the hardware infrastructure that is the internet backbone for the United States. Because I don't think they build that in, but the moment it becomes taxpayer-funded infrastructure and it's owned by the government, you know, then they're almost under an obligation to create an FCC for the internet. I don't want that.
I want to say the seven dirty words.
Well, I'm less concerned about the seven dirty words and what Bit's talking about, where they're monitoring. You know, at some point you go through a backbone server in which they scrutinize your packets for decency and Americanism and so on and so forth. It's like that's a scary concept. That is China, like you said. What makes this really bad is a number of people are eventually going to have to pay for the strikes if there's enough false things, because the end result of if you get too many strikes is they turn your internet off. They don't shut the pipe off. So if you have something that needs internet. But anytime you open a browser, it will redirect to the, you're a pirate, you can't access the internet.
So your punishment is no internet access rather than assessing the actual property for like a restitution to the party that has the loss.
Yes.
So, it doesn't make any sense. It's like if I get sued for causing damage of a vehicle and they take me to civil court, I have to pay restitution. To the party I harmed.
Oh, no, no, but see, they made it very clear. This is not about stopping. This is not about.
It cannot be lack of internet service because I have movies or doing whatever, torrents or something. Then there should be, it should be handled individually within property rights, and that's the end of it. And the government basically tell the content providers, sorry, it's not our place.
Marcel,
thank you. Have a nice day.
It's not the government. It's the ISPs. The ISPs are who's signing on board with this, which is what's even more. Basically, they're passing the libel buck.
So how are they going to profit from this? AT&T, are they getting paid to sign on board for this or something?
That's a little gray. They will get paid for the review fees. They'll get a cut of the review fees that go to the third party review agency.
Sounds like we need an investigation.
I really hate this greed.
Yeah, like I said, it's in their best interest to take as many frivolous things as possible. Because like I said, when you get to that fifth or tenth strike or whatever it is that turns your internet off, if you don't pay the blah bucks to have at least one of those strikes removed for an illegitimate thing, you don't have internet anymore. So it's like they want as many frivolous things as possible, so people have to go, I didn't do anything wrong, but here's my I didn't do anything wrong money, and here's some more I didn't do anything wrong money, and here's some more.
I have a hypothetical scenario. What if a whole bunch of people actually did that out of protest and, nobody can pay for internet?
Do you honestly think people could survive without internet in today's society for a prolonged period?
No, that's why I just said Russia's
going to be real. They can back up on someone else's every now and then.
I don't know.
Russia,
they can piggyback off the water route, whatever. They can use, pay phones or something. It'll be easy.
Yeah. Yeah.
Maybe we can set up server farms in Mali,
So you almost need it. Okay. The whole thing.
We can tie in backbones that run with oil pipelines in Africa and Nigeria. That'll be our proxy hubs over there, too.
Yeah. Basically, you just...
All kinds of business models pop up.
I know. I'm thinking of... You're right. This is the anti-piracy... and you know what? If you're accessing any fringe sites or anything that might be morally yada yada that somebody might just complain about to try and get it offline or yada yada and so forth, you know what? $2 to $5 a month for a proxy node to protect you from getting the black mark. Yeah, people would pay it. People would pay it very quickly. You're right. But you shouldn't have to. I mean,
that's... No, I know. I mean, it's I guarantee you, this stuff goes on, and they start, you know, it becomes more than educational or whatever this is. Just watch.
Well, and you know what? The people who are really doing all the illegal things, they're already doing what we're talking about anyways. I mean, that became obvious when they went after all the... peer-to-peer networks like Kazaa and so forth. Something that didn't make mass public lines, but dozens of the people they sued were not the actual pirates. They were people who were being spoofed or had like malware put on their system to use it as a proxy or so on and so forth. And some of them, it was ironclad obvious that that's what happened. There were others where, you know, they couldn't prove it, but there were a lot of those cases where they were going after innocent people, but that didn't really make the press back then. But it's these people don't use their own line; they use somebody else's by any means possible. That's like if they're smart. There are people who are dumb enough to use their own line.
All right, so Amazon, right?
Yes. Moving on to the end.
I will say I already pre-ordered Kindle Fire.
You pre-ordered a Kindle Fire? Okay.
Yes.
Yeah.
She is gonna get the Kindle Fire. I guess for a tablet desk. I don't consider Kindle tablets, but.
Well, the Kindle Fire is a tablet because it's running Android. It's not e-ink.
A tablet is the old school, like, oh, okay, you get for signatures and stuff at a hospital.
Actually, it's more a slate. Because tablets.
It's not a form factor, but I don't consider it. I mean, it's to me, okay, it's.
You're too old school, man.
Branding, sure, it's a Kindle first and foremost with all of the Amazon services, right? And Android is a bonus. Is what I consider, but primarily my wife really likes it. It's going to run Flash. She has the full power of the web. And I know people will laugh at that, but my wife's network of friends send all these ridiculous Flash funny jokes and all this other crap that, you know, I don't really even pay attention to. But that's what she likes. That's her world. She likes to be able to just not have to worry about is this going to load in my Safari browser.
Yeah, then that is becoming harder and harder to make happy.
Yeah, so she's happy with that, and she can do everything she wants to do. She still wants to get the MacBook Air replace her iMac, and because I know she wants to give her iMac to her oldest son for his school and stuff. But I'm probably going to get the $79 Kindle coming up.
Well, I will tell you about one thing. Before we get back into the fire, there's one Kindle. Amazon launched another new Kindle that is really not getting any press. The Touch, and I'm like, yeah,
the one I want.
Yeah, and it's here's the thing: if you don't want Audible, you should get the Touch, because when I was using my Kindle more than once, I felt like. Because it's become a conditioned behavior because of our smartphones and everything, I felt like I just tried to touch the screen, and I just, oops. So unless you want the Audible books and the speaking and so on and all of that, you should really consider the Touch, because it's only like $10 more.
I don't know. I mean, I'm not quite there where I'm always touching the screen. I'm more. BlackBerry style, you know, and my Humphrey has the hard
disk. Then you'll be fine with the regular one. But it's like, I mean, they're basically the same price, and they have longer battery life, which I can't figure out. It's like,
can you
it's...
imagine? I know, and I almost got that $114 Kindle a while back, and I'm glad I waited, because I'm really now impressed with their prices. Amazon's just kicking ass. I have been one of their probably longest-running customers. And they always tell me that, like, if I have a slight problem, that's them, you can call them up. And every time I call them up, it never without fail. So they go, man, you have been with us from the beginning of the show.
Yeah, back when they were actually cheap.
It's cool that they say that, though. You know, that's it's kind of a nice thing.
Yeah. Anyways, back to the Fire. It's what people like you want, a 7-inch. I still prefer the larger, the 10-inch, but it's like...
This is what my wife, dude.
I know, but you've been... I know the Kindle Fire for your wife, but I'm referring to the 7-inch. You have been complaining endlessly. You want...
Amazon hit it on the nail. Did you hear what that guy said? Well, I see his name. We're doing it 7-inch. Why? Because it makes sense. He does it in a, shall I say, quote-unquote, Steve Jobs way. Because he just comes out and says it. It's not like some this monotone, usually boring thing that other companies tend to fail at presentation. He came right out and said, look, you know why we're 7-inch? Because everybody wants to hold the damn thing in one hand. Yes! Thank you.
And maybe that's one of the reasons I want a 10-inch. I have really big hands, so a 10-inch fits just fine in one hand for me. Okay, well, again, I don't understand why you don't want the 10-inch, but anyways. It's got 8 gig of internal storage, which admittedly isn't a lot, but for a purely slaty device, it is...
How much storage do you get with it? I mean, can you download all the Android?
Yes, it's Android. It's just been Amazonified. So yes, you can get all the Android apps and stuff and yada yada.
That's pretty cool.
It does get something you don't get with most Android devices, and that is you get access to the Amazon Cloud storage and content,
and
you get WhisperNet access for all the Amazon use stuff through it. So you know that's something you're not going to get with other Android devices.
How many videos ago was we brought up something like we were just talking about Amazon's infrastructure?
Yeah. To me, that's the real selling point of this thing, that you're getting access to the Amazon thing, and it's not going to count against your bandwidth because they've got the WhisperNet contract for their stuff and yada yada, which is a real selling point on something like that. Now, it's Wi-Fi only, not 3G. So.
Right, the thing is she only loves the house. But it's funny because you wrote the show notes that, well, you can just use an Android phone, and an Android phone might be my wife's next phone comes to something.
Yeah. Well, no, and that...
The cool factor finally wore off. You know what did it? We had, it was like last week or the week before?
Mm-hmm.
And she said, okay, I'm done. We had, because the entire week, her phone dropped. Calls, like,
yeah, that's very much like why I'm getting rid of the cable box here. It was like it was things it had been doing, but it did them like 8 times, and I was like, forget it, done, no more.
And get this, the other straw that broke Kim's back for her iPhone was, you know, her friends sending more and more flash content to it. And of course, the purest Apple was to say, HTML5, flash is so amazing. Which they don't get that, you know, the heavy amount of the world still uses flash.
Well, no, at the end of the day, it doesn't matter what's better. It doesn't matter, Son. None of that matters. What matters is, what are people using, what are they coming across, and how many hoops do they have to jump to subscribe to your philosophy? That's the thing.
She was like, I'm done with this. And we had some important conversations, and she found that it was just dropping too frequently, and her coworkers at work, who also have like Verizon iPhones, they drop calls too. It's funny because they all talk amongst themselves.
That's the thing. It's when Tim got up there and said, you know, well, now we have 2 antennas, so if you hold it wrong, it will adjust. And I'm like, you're still saying people are holding, or getting up, and this, yeah, yeah. Anyways. The only thing I can find that's a weakness on the Fire.
You know, and in all fairness, yeah, you know, you say that now. I know the typical Apple response will be, well, every other phone does it. The reason why it was brought up with Apple wasn't because of Apple hate. It is because it is known that that damn phone cannot hold a phone call if its life depended on it. Period. Okay? Well, my palm tree can drop bars, but damn it, it can hold a phone call. Alright? The reason why that was brought up is not because of any damn accolade or
anything. And the entire life of using my G1, I have had all, and this is over the course of years, because I've had the thing almost since they came out, I have dropped 4 total calls, and I use the thing on a daily basis. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, everybody gets a dropped call. It's just, it happens.
Yeah, you know, and then I have Europeans that say, well, come over to us, we don't get dropped calls. Well, wait a minute. Why is it that I have a Palm 3, and then I have my HTC Evo, I have my LG phones, right? Why don't they drop calls? You know, I will give Europeans have better bandwidth than you, but my other smartphones do not drop calls.
Maybe it just doesn't handle the up and down. Quite right. That's one of the few things I've noticed with the Roku here. Every so often, it'll lose network connectivity, which is part of why I invested the extra money in the one that has the Ethernet cable. I think what it is like, if the Wi-Fi drops, rather than give it time to reacquire, it just loses the thing. Maybe there's something wrong with the iPhone in that other phones, they dip, but they idle for a moment before dropping, and maybe the iPhone doesn't properly idle.
That is the only reason why the damn iPhone really got attacked. It was just notorious for not being able to hold a phone call. I can't even tell you how many forums, if they were still open and you go on to Apple support, from the original iPhone to the 3G to the 3GS, of people just bitching about dropped phone calls. And the secret, I don't want to say secret, that would be the wrong adjective, but the under-the-radar releases and patches to the 3G and 3GS to try to help drop phone calls that Apple clearly addresses in their damn, when they give you the side notes of what that installation to the phone has in it to fix. So please, that's what it is, man.
I can tell this is an issue for you. Anyways, back to the Fire. As far as I can tell, the only weakness in it is that it has roughly 7 to 8 hours battery life. You know, 8 hours continuous reading, so it doesn't have the month like you'd get on a Kindle. And it has 7.5 of peak usage, you know, video. So, I mean, that's enough to get the average person through the day. Where I find the problem is, and they say this on their site, is it's going to take you 4 hours to recharge it.
Wow.
Which means, you know, up 8 hours, down 4 hours. Up 8 hours, down 4. I'm like, that's quite a cycle there. That could be a little. I could see that bugging some people.
Yeah, we'll see. I mean, my wife will probably.
Oh no, I'll be bugging you around Thanksgiving to go. Is the 4 hour charge time getting to her, or is you know it's because it's going to depend how you use it at the end of the day.
Right. I don't know. We'll see what happens. She's real excited about it. You know, I'm curious too. You know, to see how it goes. It'll be, I guess, our first Android tablet-esque device.
See how that
goes. Okay. But I'm going to be getting that basic Kindle, you know. So.
No, it's like, if you're going to be getting the regular model,
I can't read on these damn LED screens.
No. If you're going to be getting the regular model and not the touch, you might want to splurge for the extra money for the 3G one with the WhisperNet. Because it is useful if you're going to be getting the books.
What?
But it is a little extra.
Yes, I don't care about sleep. I mean, because I have my free Wi-Fi hotspot with my Palm 3. And I use that Wi-Fi hotspot everywhere. You know?
Okay, but do you have bandwidth caps or are you on an unmetered?
No. I'm old. I'm grandfathered.
Okay. So, to anybody who's on a bandwidth cap plan, that sounds great, but you will burn through data like you can't imagine if you really start
out for the user. Data calculator, and my data would be really, really high fill.
Yeah, it's like it's worth the one-time fee to spend the extra money on the 3G version with the free WhisperNet that won't count against your bandwidth bill if you're going to be doing that. Now, if you're on a grandfathered M plan where you have unmetered, you don't care. But
that's right.
Yeah.
I was looking for I may just upgrade that for my Verizon Palmfrey to the Palmfrey 2. And then my AT&T side is undetermined. It may be a Windows phone. It may be a RIM QNX. We'll see what happens.
If you're gonna go Windows, wait till Windows 8. Although I don't recommend you go that route. And if you're going to go pre, I would wait until the end of this month when HP decides whether or not they're leaving the business forever.
It's going to happen in December, when my contracts are all of them in December. And,
oh, wait, it's December 3rd, isn't it, when HP makes their announcement?
I guess.
So, there's a bunch of Palm 33s from AT&T on eBay. It's insane. You get them for about
Nice.
Oh yeah, I almost picked one up, but I'm just not gonna go to the house again. But I'll tell you, my Verizon side, because I want to keep that Wi-Fi hotspot and be grandfathered in. So if they don't let me upgrade, and then I lose it, if they take that away.
I know, that's the thing. I think they're going to make everybody lose those as they upgrade because they want them gone. AT&T is trying to find every loophole they can to get rid of them, and Verizon's looking at the prospect of doing it. So,
I'll be like Steve Wozniak and have like four phones
just for a specific purpose. Well, no, and what's really funny? Wozniak has like a grandfathered in like special iPlan they never really offered because he was Wozniak.
They don't really offer it. They just didn't offer it.
I agree with
him
because that's how you play it.
It's unlimited international data roaming.
Yeah. It's like, they don't offer that anymore.
He pays like $100 a month for it.
Yeah, but you pay that on the regular plans anyways.
Yeah.
It's like...